Just to begin with this presentation, how many of you are users of Schwind? Because many times, sir, when are you going to use, Dr. Ramamurthy? Okay, so I'm one of the very, very early users of Schwind. I started last year, April, May. And like I said, people always ask me, which is your favorite machine? Because our OR has many of those machines. And I remember our chairman always keeps saying that comparison is a thief of joy. If you compare, then everything, you lose the fun of doing it. So every machine is good. But today being the day where we are going to discuss about Schwind, one thing when I started using this machine is the freedom in which you can do whatever you want. Like Dr. Kamal said, if you want to innovate something, you want to play around with something. And my fellows like Pooja, Ravish, and all of them here, I mean, there's never been a day where we would not go and look at what else can we do in this patient. I think one thing I want to tell you is that you are given a very, a lot of freedom to a surgeon to play around with the machine. That's one big difference. The second difference is compared to the other technologies. The second difference is it's not that it's the only machine which can do many things, what we're going to show here. I'm sure Alcon, Mel, and Bosch and Lomb can also do. But there is always that fear among the people who made those softwares and machines that you're going to misuse it for some reason. They don't really trust you. I'm sure they must be having their various reasons. They just lock everything in. So you want to do something, you cannot deviate from what is given by the company manual. So that's where the problem comes. So that is where I think Schwind has kept it very open. You're virtually free to do what you want, choose what you want. So
yeah, thank you. That's really, it was on intention and on purpose that we brought into the software many options, many possibilities where you can adjust higher order aberrations, where you can adjust reflections. Okay, thank you.
You can be on the stage. This, you're the guest.
Thank you. So thank you for all this preparation here, and thank you to IOL Care for all this making this possible, for setting the stage up, and I'm glad to be here. Yeah, thank you for this invitation, and I'm glad that you're also here to join us and to listen to all the speakers. So I was starting to say that the software is developed in a way that it allows many possibilities. You have seen this over many years in the customized treatment, for example, where you can play around with the higher order to optimize and to minimize the ablation depths, to optimize the reflection, especially in keratoconus patients where the reflection is maybe not that significant, but where you can find a reflection which saves tissue. So over the years, also PTK for the phototherapeutic approach was an interesting part. And I personally have seen many patients being very thankful for the PTK approach, not a typical way of doing reflective treatment, but these patients which can be helped by the PTK are very thankful. So most recently, 2 years ago, we enlarged our options for the PTK and called it PTK Toolbox, which allows multiple functionalities. And I think over these next minutes, so we will see some more features and possibilities.
So
about
what
this.
What we have done is, the good part of this part of the story is that we are able to connect the diagnostics to this screen. I mean, that's, many machines don't allow that. So we don't need to do a presentation to understand all this. So I think most of you are Schwind users. For somebody who's new, I think you just know that these are all the parameters out there, the PressBMax, the PTK comparison, all this stuff. But let's go to the main thing. For example, for a planning, let's go to the planning. That's when you start knowing how versatile. Okay. So when you get into this planning, we all know this thing. AF is aberration free, OW is ocular wavefront, and CW is corneal wavefront. For people like Dr. Ramamurthy who are used to Alcon, this is AFS optimized, CW is Contura, and OW is our wavefront guided treatment, which we both know that it never worked. But here, I'm I don't have that. Anybody using the wavefront guided treatment in this? You use which one? No. Ocular wavefront. But the Pyramus is right. They've not introduced it in India, Vipin. We don't have it in India.
It's we have done only two cases with an ocular wavefront where our K reading and then a manifest astigmatism was a huge difference.
We'll come to that story. This is the same problem I think me and Dr. Ramamurthy have been facing with the Contura is that they don't match. But this is how it is. But let's take a patient. This is how I would do. It's like you have all the options, but how would I choose whether I want to do a AW, OW, or CW? So we just take one patient, any patient, just take a patient. Then we could have a discussion about how each one of you would do. Okay, let's look at this patient's refraction as this. You have all these things coming up. So what's interesting here is that you have a bunch of things downstairs. You can choose trans-PRK, PRK, LASIK, LASIK, femto-LASIK, and relift. I want to ask you, what is relift?
Okay.
How does the machine alter your program for a relift? Anybody use the relift program here? So this is all new for all of us. Yeah.
The idea behind the relift is, if you have a former LASIK or femto-LASIK treatment, and this patient is not happy, and you're going to retreat this patient, where you just lift the flap, then you do your ablation, your refractive correction, and you bring the flap back. And then you click on relift. Because the difference, if you go on LASIK or femto-LASIK, the software will assume that you do a cut. A cut with a microkeratome or a femtosecond laser. And as it is known, just by a cut without refractive correction, the biomechanics get a little bit more weaker and the spherical aberration increase. And this is considered in LASIK and femto-LASIK. So now imagine you do a retreatment. The patient already had a cut, and now the software would use LASIK or femto-LASIK for the retreatment. So it would compensate unnecessarily for spherical aberration, for a change in biomechanics, which already took place many months, many years back ago at the very first treatment, but not at this secondary treatment. Therefore, we implemented the bottom relift, and the difference will be in the spherical aberrations, in the amount of spherical aberrations the software is compensating for.
Just sorry to break you. Can we just look at this patient, what we get in normal, and then the relift? Basically, it compensates for a spherical aberration induced by that flap, which is already there.
Exactly.
It is an assumption, or it takes it from the topography?
The spherical aberrations, which comes from the flat creation, is taken from the literature. So it's published originally, I think, from Ron Krüger, how many spherical aberrations will be created by a microkeratome cut or femtosecond cut. And these spherical aberrations will be added to the ablation profile. On top of this, the ablation itself, the refractive component you are going to treat, also will further weaken. As it removes tissue, it will further weaken the biomechanics of the cornea. And therefore, this weakening will further create additional spherical aberrations. And this will be considered in all of these treatments anyway of surface, LASIK, femto-LASIK, or relift. But again, for LASIK and femto-LASIK, it will add on top the biomechanical changes from the cut.
So the relift will be different in femto-LASIK, and relift will be different in LASIK?
No, the LASIK or the femto-LASIK already had happened before in the very first treatment. So it was already compensated in the past. So now we only need to compensate for the ablation depths. We will go on to correct the reflection.
So if you move on, so for example, if you go out to AF, just say okay, just do a LASIK. See, we'll go back, just to cancel. I learned something about to know which is better from their own application specialist. He says that irrespective of what you do at the end, you always put the PRK mode, put the PRK, just then go forward. Doesn't matter, at the end you'll do a LASIK. Because when the machine calculates in a PRK mode, it calculates, it gives you much more variation. For example, this isn't just a plain ablation-free treatment. So you will have a red in the center, green, blue, and all that stuff. You don't see anything happening at all in this patient. But let's go back and put a CW. So let's put a CW. So it's the same patient. Same refractive error, same cylinder, same axis, PRK. So here also you don't see anything much happening because you've already entered your refractive error. But if you want to be very, very sure that you're treating something higher order aberration, you have to keep go back again and keep everything zero. Now you see the difference. So this patient, when you played with the wavefront aberration-free, you did not know what it was correcting. The aberration-free, if you want, I'll play it again. The aberration-free and CW was giving you exactly the same picture. But in the aberration-free, you can't put zero and you'll never get this picture. That means this patient has, even when you put at zero aberration, it gives you a 10 microns ablation. That means it is correcting that much of maybe coma. So now what I do is go back and I know that I want to do a CW for this patient. This is, and then I just click the LASIK or flap, whatever, and do it. This is the way I do it in my practice to see how to customize this. I can tell it again, even though it may look a little confusing. So any question? You had some question?
Basically, you're needing 9 microns more.
See, for example...
Because the ablation depth increased.
No. Just hold on. If you just put this -2, let's look. Go back to this again. I know it's confusing first time. Okay. So, this is 39. An ablation map of a patient with the -2. You don't know whether you have to do an AF, CW, OW. We don't have any clue about it because you are -2. If you go back again, so first thing is you make it zero. You are in AF, right?
Yes. No,
this is CW. Go to AF. Then you'll just for the comparison, I'm just doing. It just takes a few minutes. Just put the, now, yeah. Just say you're not exported. No, keep it zero because let's see what happens when you do an EF zero. You'll not see anything. You cannot go ahead at all because EF is not customized. But if you do a same thing with CW for the same patient, you can. This one. Dr. Ramamurthy sir is exactly the same as our femto contura where you do. But here, everything is in one screen button. But there is an interesting part. But if you don't put zero and check it, you will not see a difference between AF or CW or OW. Everything looks the same. Now, I know that this machine is burning this much. Look at the ablation, 18 microns of ablation because there is a lot of a coma, there's a lot of things to be corrected. If you feel that the machine, this is where, sir, I think this scores over everybody else. I don't know how many of you use this button. There is a manager button, right? When you click the manager button, use the pyramid. What the machine says is, 1 minute. You can do two things. You feel that it is burning a lot of these ablations, so that's why you're actually, even if you keep zero, you're actually hitting 18 microns. So that's where I think it scores over every other machine. We just say minimize depth. It will take a few more minutes. What it is doing is, it is creating a permutation of combination of what aberration it should correct and what it should remain. So it will, because it is not just taking off some here and there, it's going into multiple mathematical calculations, and then it will tell me that how much it has, and it will reduce your amount of ablation unnecessarily. That it will only take out what is necessary, the rest it will keep. So your ablation sometimes may go down by 5 microns, 10 microns, or 15 microns. It takes time because it is slow process.
It's a try and error. It's not an algorithm. It's just trying which aberrations are beneficial to save tissue. So it checks all the possibilities we have in the background, and that takes some
Rohit,
seconds.
This is from the Opticon Correctron Scout or the Cirrus?
The Cirrus.
So it does the same thing on the Opticon Correctron Scout?
Maybe, yes, it's the same.
Yeah, it does.
Same.
We
it's
have
the same.
That.
But, you know, that's what I said. You know, this kind of a thing, because it is trying to give you a more refined thing. But what I said is, it's important that you keep in the PRK mode and do all this. Because if you put it in a, see now, how much did it reduce, Pooja? So it says that
max 5 microns.
It's very interesting. See, it has knocked off all the unwanted ones. So it knocked off, then you know, then you go back, apply.
Yes, it's also possible with the scout
move forward. Okay, say okay. And now you can see what was 18 became 5.
4 microns.
And 5 microns. And now you go back to patient data, hit your minus whatever your refractive error is, minus 2, minus whatever, doesn't matter. Now you hit femtolasic and say OK, say go to OK. It's collected. Now you don't see what has happened because it's happened at the back. And then you say apply. The zone is high, but doesn't matter. Apply, move forward. Doesn't matter. It has some, it's very interesting. It has some thing. And now, it gives you like a signal, red, green, and all. If your RST is low, then you move forward. Then you have the complete treatment program. It tells you the coma treated, the trefoil, the spherical aberration treated.
Let me add a point. These spherical aberrations you see here, with the same wavefront, with the same refraction you put in, will be different if you choose PRK, or if you choose LASIK, or relift. Remember, these three possibilities to go on the surface, to go intrastromal, creating a cut, and to do relift. This will be indicating different aberrations just by weakening the corneal structure due to the cut.
I have a question for you. At the end, we get this map. This is what is going to correct, or this is what is going to induce?
This is what will be corrected.
Yeah. So clear on this?
How do you decide what needs to be corrected and what needs to be left behind?
If you go back to that map, you can also decide. Ignore this, we'll make a new one. What I do sometimes is, if I don't have the time to do all this, wait for that machine to calculate, you can also do it yourself, manually. I'll show you how it's done. Keep it zero, move forward. No, zero. Oh, PRK, yeah, PRK. Go to the manager. See, go back. Just go back. One of the most beautiful part of this machine happens hidden here. This row. It's your cruise. This is where it makes you the toolbox, because it's where you actually start playing with it. If you go back to the manager, go to the pyramid. what I want to do is sometimes it may not be very clear, but if you look at the legend out there, this side. So I can just say I want to only correct the coma in this patient. I don't want everything else to be bothered. So what I do is all the fourth order just skip. No. I want to correct coma. Just keep the coma and keep everything off. Go spherical aberration also. So I can do this. So you can make the machine do it for you, or you can do it yourself. So the reason I believe in the machine doing it for me is, it's just not a mathematical calculation that I remove two and everything else will be all right. What it's trying to do, according to me, is also trying to see how they interact with each other. How friendly are they, how unfriendly are they, and then it gives you a balance. Am I right, Thomas?
Yes, you're right.
Yes, it's based on the RMS, root mean square function. So if you go, just keep going, I'll show you. Just keep going. Go to the final step. Final. Doesn't matter, don't worry. This is where the machine, it's coming from your RMS. Clear on this?
Do you do this for all RMS values, or you have a cutoff beyond which
it,
only you do?
I do it for every patient. Pooja or Prerna will, they do it and see which would be the best patient, best option for this patient. Then we decide I should do a, because it doesn't cost me at all, because whether I do an AF, Vipin Dugal is still not charging for doing a CW. So what happens is, it takes a few minutes more, but you customize for every patient. There are times they tell me, one eye AF is, AF and CW are both equal, we don't need to burn more, we'll do a AF. There are one eye, we may do a CW. Because every single patient may take a few minutes more, but you're customizing very beautifully. Two important thing is, if you want to really see how this is done, I do it, I don't know about others, I do it in a PRK mode. Because PRK mode gives you a more, for me, it gives you more that visual picture.
Will the calculation be different in a femto mode?
Will it
consider the flap thickness or the surface irregularity and all that, and that's why you're doing it in the PRK mode?
I don't think so, but because the ablation calculation must be the same for the whole corneal surface, as long as you're not putting the, because it's calculated the same way, but I can try it also in the same patient, what happens to the femto mode, because I've been used to doing this. Yeah, how you can just, would you like to answer? Go back. Minimize plus and maximize. Is minimize plus and thing is?
Yeah.
This is mag. Yeah. They want to know about this. Even you can explain.
We have the minimized and the minimize plus. The minimize plus is more aggressive in saving tissue. So in the minimize plus, for sure, it will remain to correct all the higher orders, which are significant, which are highlighted in red, like the coma which we see here in this example. In the minimize, it has more freedom to make depth of ablation or to reduce the ablation depth. Therefore, the minimize plus is more aggressive and more tissue saving. And the difference between the depth and the volume is the depth is intended for the myopics, because typically in a myopia, the ablation depth is in the central area, whereas in hyperopia, you have the volume. So not in all, but mainly in the most cases, if you want to save tissue in hyperopic, you go for minimized volume.
Yeah.
And if you want to go for myopic or myopic astigmatism, you go for minimized depth. And if you are very accurate, if you are very precise, you check for both opportunities. Because sometimes you find some exceptions on that rule.
I have a question. You just said that for hyperops, if you want to save tissue,
go to minimize volume.
Minimize volume.
For myopes, it's depth.
No. But usually hyperopes, we fire in the periphery where the thickness is not an issue, unlike in the center.
No, if you want to, that's what he said. Because I have
any
never...
Any particular indication where we need it?
Hyperopia, basically. So, see, anything which is hyperopia, where you are really looking at reducing... See, may if you are treating a very high hyperope, 6, 7 and... Some hyperopes loss.
That's what I was hinting at. Does it give me a slightly higher range than what I would have probably done without using that?
No, the range is the same. It just looks more on the volume. As we see here, we have the volume and the ablation depths. So it considers both aspects. For the volume, if you click on that, it saves and it looks for aberrations which are beneficial to save volume overall. And it might be that you you save a lot of tissue, despite that the center ablation is not that much saved. So if you want to be sure that you save depth of ablation, then you go for minimized depth, especially in keratoconus maybe.
What's interesting here, it gives you your offset, it gives you the, it can go up to your zone, can go up to around 9 millimeters, and all this part of it. Then. This is anyway, we are still using the PRK mode, so it's still not gone to the other mode, but this
was
is
a,
how...
Well, there was a question. RMS?
RMS-HO.
RMS-HO is higher order aberrations.
And total is?
Total
RMS-HO is... your coma and third order and below. The total is your defocus and everything together, your myopia and everything together.
And including the refraction.
When you said you compare and you decide which is better, AF or CW, how do you decide? I mean, what parameters do you consider?
No, that's what I looked at this. If you go back to, if you have a perfectly normal patient who does not require CW, this whole thing, this map will still show there will be around 2 microns, 3 microns here. Anything more than 8 to 10 microns, if it's showing up, it means that it is correcting that much of irregularity. Up to 10 microns means you're looking at close to half or more than half a diopter of irregularity is corrected just by keeping it zero. See, I learned, and Dr. Ramurthy sir also learned this concept from the topography of topo-guided treatments of thing. From, I think they also use the same concept of contoura. It's exactly the same principle. But advantage here is that you have everything on a click of a button and you can modulate your aberrations. You can put a PRK or a femto, whatever mode.
Do you get the zero ablation also?
Yes, that means it's perfect.
How many times in your experience?
Around 90% of the time.
Okay. And when it comes there, then you
when
have
you
to
choose both, doesn't
customize.
Matter. Yeah. No, they don't do it because the machine, what is correcting, is not correcting. You can see it's not the myopic correction in the center. It's correcting the irregularities.
But
see, the patient at the end of it may, if you don't do it, you may end up have a perfect 20/20, but he'll complain of glare, halos, and a lot of other things because inducing more of aberrations.
We have around 20 patients done, one eye AF and the other eye CW. Few patients, not all patients, they went into some plus 0.75, plus 1 hyperopia.
They usually regress back.
But should we, my question is, should we change the target in the refraction?
No, nothing.
No.
I keep it exactly the same and we've been doing regularly most of my patients. Like I said, like he asked the question, 90% of the time you don't need CW. It's only that 10%. Especially this patient definitely needs it. Because, I have treated many unhappy corneas where they have zero refractive error using one of these technologies by keeping zero, the ablation was 22. That means technically, next day morning, I should have got a plus one, which we did not get. The reason being, it is not treating as a myopic or hyperopic correction. It is treating irregularities of your cornea.
So it is making the surface
smooth. So it will not induce myopia to you because it will make the cornea more regular. So this whole approach of this is not to induce. It does not induce anything. It just irons out irregularities.
Not to.
See, there are really very simple thumb rules for this. Like, there is nobody knows what is the good higher order aberration, lower order aberration. So, if you are using it to correct your power, this works according to me really well because I use the same concept in contour also.
No, you have given us the tool practically means putting zero refraction and seeing how much ablation is being done.
That is one of the good ways of looking at do you need to treat this or you need to just go back like she said about the aberration free.
Would you check for these aberrations even if the patient is correcting to 6-6?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you'll still like to treat these aberrations?
Yeah.
Okay.
See, what I put here, let's assume that this patient is who's come to me, let's forget about the pre-op. He's a post-refractive surgery unhappy patient. He's come to you because he's not happy because he's glare. This is exactly how I treat him. Keep everything zero, do this, do a trans-PRK, flap lift or whatever you want and be corrected. That's it. That's it. But there are times, yes. No, you can do it. I don't want to confuse you. You can choose any mode. I'm used to doing that because that's why I said, but you can choose any mode. Am I right?
Yeah.
So cutoff, Rohit, is what, 10 microns? What's your cutoff?
There's nothing, I consider anything about 8 to 10 microns because if you're looking at 10 microns, you're looking at 0.75 diopters. That means anything more than 0.5 diopters makes your patients terribly unhappy.
It's the same old question, Rohit. I mean, whenever the cornea is irregular, all these things benefit, but the garden variety of refractive error, say minus 3 diopters, minus 3.5 with a small cylinder, whether you just correct the refractive error or do all this, do the patients subjectively experience a difference in the quality of vision?
Yes, sir. Definitely, because we've been checking their different levels of aberrations. Basically, the quality of vision is definitely different because we after 1 month, we do a lot of quality assessment for them. And especially, that's why we picked this patient. I think Pooja did a good job of picking this right patient. Because this patient, you know from your experience that if you have a 14 microns of ablation, it is not something which is... And initially, I was also concerned like her. I used to go back and do the same on a topo-guided treatment of our thing, you would always get something like 2 microns difference, but it means that both are working in the same way.
If we want to see the influence from the higher order aberrations on the refraction, you can go to comparison. And in the comparison, you can load in the wavefront map, and you will see the higher order aberrations and the effect on the amount of sphere and cylinder. Yes. Click here, select one case, maybe select twice the same case. So it loads
same
in the wavefront.
Select twice.
And here we see exactly the higher order refraction for this particular wavefront is about 0.87 diopters, 0.39 and 172. But look on the selected optical zone of 8.5 millimeter. Can we choose this to 4 millimeter, please? And press apply. And then we see how the higher order refraction changes. Look, it's almost zero. So be aware that the pupil diameter is a critical point if you do for the customized treatment. So on such a patient, you check for the photopic pupil size and the mesopic pupil size. And you can check the effect at the two optical zones, one for photopic and one for mesopic.
So this is, I think, sir, your question. I don't know whether it's audible, that if I had not corrected this patient for whatever, he would have induced about that much of ablation, sorry, that much of his refractive error was based on his irregularity. And if you increase your zone to 7, if it's a larger pupil, it becomes 0.75, which means that there is more of spherical aberration and coma out there. So these are the small things which makes you start feeling that, you know, there is a lot more of this machine where you can play with. That's what excites you. Anything else on this particular thing?
From whatever we have discussed just now, once you know that it is burning more tissue, say, supposing what example you gave as 15 microns, then you go back and do a corneal wavefront?
Yes.
And if it is something less than something like around 4 or so, you just go away to your regular mode.
Yes, yes. Yeah. After we do, after, I mean, this is all done to prove that this patient needs that customized wavefront treatment. That is the most important thing, because, see, for example, every patient you put them into customized wavefront doesn't make any sense. So when you, it's like saying that you do Contura for everybody who walks into your clinic. Customized wavefront is something very similar to what Contura is. It's no different from Contura. People using Schwind can also call it Contura because it is exactly a topography guided treatment. When I actually plot the Contura maps and this one, they're more or less similar. They're more or less the same.
You just passed a statement that ocular wavefront is really not so useful.
No, it is useful, but we don't have it. But I think Dr. Ramurthy can comment on it, because the maximum work of ocular Boschenlohm Hartmannschak work has been done by him in Asia probably. But again, these problems still existed then also, but we would probably, the lens would negate a lot maybe, so we never knew what it is. But today, being such a dominant force today, is not your quantity of vision being a quality of vision. We have to be very good with all these things. For example, if a pupil change from 4 to 7 can change the refraction by 0.5 diopters, that means it's definitely going to be unhappy with your surgery.
One point, Dr. Ramurthy, if at all customized ocular wavefront will help, I think it's in some patients who are partially amblyopic.
I think all these concepts were there, you know, we are talking about supervision and increasing vision beyond 6x3, 6x2, etc., to the limit of the ganglion cells. There's a lot of hype about this, and zeoptics seemed to be the byword about 15 years back, and we used to charge patients extra for that. But then slowly, as Rohit said, we all realized that it's not the quantity but the quality of vision which is more important. And it went by. And then what you are referring to is to the concept of aberopia. That is, you correct aberrations and the vision comes up. It was promoted by one of prominent ophthalmologists. I think it never really got accepted. And I think by and large, experience never proved that it helps. And today, I think the basic platform is wavefront optimized, and all other things are being built upon this. And definitely anything less than a HORMS of less than 0.4 microns, I think it's not even worth considering wavefront guided ablation.
Rohit, what's your percentage of this and this?
Maybe around 20% is CW and 80% is AF. But I just check for every patient.
Persisting with my question, you know.
But if you're sorry, so just to complete his question, for all keratoconus, all recorrections, for all irregular corneas, without question CW. Any recorrection is CW.
Sir, I have a question.
Sir, Dr. Ramurthy is saying something.
No, why I asked that earlier question was, you know, objectively we are able to measure, we treat with Contura, I mean, or normalize. But to be very frank, when we subjectively question the patient, we have even done some patients, one eye Contura, the other eye without Contura. They are not really able to make a big difference in what they perceive. So all these things are measurable, and it makes logic and sense to do this. But just like putting in aspheric intraocular lenses, are the patients experiencing a real difference in their real life situation as far as the quality of vision they perceive, whether you do the normal treatment or at least my experience with the other platform is not that it greatly benefits them.
In fact, Rushad, when he was with me, he did this work and we submitted, we published in JRS last year, where subjectively and objectively we did Contura and other eye this one. Like you rightly said, they did not have a complaint. They were reading well, but the challenge was in when you actually did them in low contrast, contrast sensitivity, and when you're using low light conditions, this was way ahead of it. But patients, you know, they accept whatever you give, they accept it as how it is. They really don't know that, you know, if you give them better only then you probably would know. But in today's world, especially case like this, is definitely going to be unhappy. There are enough number of people who come to you being unhappy, you know. They still have glare, which lasts for a long. Many times they have glare, but they neuroadapt to it. But these patients don't have it at all. But if you have one in your tool, my thing is, why not use it? And if you don't have to pay for it, like the Zioptics era where you had to pay for every patient. So we used to think 10 times before we actually do a Zioptics because we were not really sure. But here it's free. You said you asked something?
Rohit, please don't keep saying it's free, it's free, it's free.
So far it's free. So,
one question. So there is something similar in the Keratron Scout, the point spread function. Does it make sense to have a look at that? Or Zernike's coefficients, they have the PFS? The PSF.
The point spread function is a good measure, a quick measure for you to know how bad is your quality of your optics. So, but however, when if you are using a point spread function of any of these machines, which is a topographer, you're just getting half the picture. The best way to measure the point spread function is to use the like an eye trace or one of the abrometers, because then you'll get a complete picture, because the lens also has a huge role in balancing it out. So if you take this point spread function of this particular patient, it may look very bad, but the lens would have probably corrected it off for him.
What I usually do is I take the RMS value for ocular wavefront and corneal wavefront, and if it is more, I go for corneal wavefront. But many times I see that the corneal wavefront value will be higher, but the ocular wavefront value will be lower. In such a situation, do we correct the corneal wavefront or go for aberration-free thinking that the lens will balance it out?
There is no correct answer for this, because there is always a dominance of, inner optics, there is always a dominance of whether the lens dominates over the cornea or the cornea dominates over the lens. When we, like Naren spoke about this whole model, when we are working on it, there are patients where the cornea has a very high level of astigmatism, but the patient acceptance is just 0.25, because there the lens is dominating. So you don't know whether, see, if you correct the cornea, then the lens dominance may change. So because it's a cornea-based procedure, you correct whatever the cornea has. The lens in a younger patient always adjusts to the cornea. The lens is a more adapting to corneal changes. So that's what we have seen in our work. That's why many times there is a something called as in Alcon calls it as a TMR, that topography modified refraction, where they have to balance the lens and the other things. But even if you don't do it, the patients are happy. So that means the lens is very adaptable in a younger patient. We go to the next case, which this is what? This is a keratoconus case. So we go to, if you going to, okay, again, here it directly goes to CW, right? So it goes to CW. So again, we use the same thing. Don't write any refractive error out here. Just go to the PRK mode. Because anyway, we are doing a PRK here. And you can see that this is the ablation profile. Keep it to 6 millimeter zone, because the zones, okay, just keep 6 millimeter zone. The PACI is 443, so we need to save as much as tissue as possible. You can see that the maximum ablation is 7, and the center is 7. So again, go to, no, wait, just don't be in a hurry. just go to manager, just go to pyramid, again do this, because what happens, just hold on, in the keratoconus patients, you'll have a lot of unwanted aberrations, which is adding up to your ablation profile. So go to maximize depth, because this is keratoconus, you can take it as a myopia, press it up please, and it's optimizing. It's trying to tell you which one you should keep, which one you should not. Right, Thomas?
Right.
So we can ask some questions before it actually does something. He has a question.
How does the machine know which are the good ones and which are the bad ones? I mean, are there some principles by which you go?
There's a color coded here, sir. If you look at the legend, can you press the this? No. Put the cursor on the legend. So any value above 0.5 comes as red color in this. Put one of the red. Yeah, there. So when you say first, the machine takes out the higher ones, or it keeps the higher ones, takes out the ones which are the green or yellow ones.
No, yeah. If you see some of the HORMS graphs, some are on the positive side, some are on the negative side, and there's a natural way of neutralizing each other. And when you selectively take out some and leave behind some, you might be leaving behind an optics which is worse than what we started out with. But so what is the logic that is applied to selectively treat some and not treat some?
Yes, it will always treat the one which are significant, which are red. Can we point it on? Yeah. This one will always be treated. And between the green one and the orange one, he's choosing, the software is choosing the aberrations which are beneficial to save tissue or to optimize the volume. And it might be that it picks up this one because it saves tissue, and another one it's not picked up because it's not saving tissue. And the red ones always will be saved.
So if I answer this question for you, I also had the same doubt in mind. This software does not allow you to understand that very well, but if I go back from the optics, you have used that Hartmann-Shack from the Xiwave. The new Xiwave has a software. What it does is it uses a programmable kind of MATLAB based one, I don't know what, where each ablation you take it out, it tells you how is the effect on the quality of vision. So that means virtually there is a method in which all software knows what aberrations you take out to give you the best form of vision. It's very interesting, sir, it's for one of these patients, when I took off one of the aberrations, it actually became worse, as you rightly said. So I put that aberration, it became better. So we can show that video. I had made a small video of it. So that means there is a mathematical way in which they can do it. And Abhijit is an expert in this. If you can comment on this particular subject, how does a machine know which one it should keep and which one it should take out?
Rohit, I've actually, what you're saying is so true. There are some patients on the keratocon scout, at times I just sit on the machine and randomly want to take off some, and I look at the RMS and the PSF, they suddenly go haywire. Yeah,
absolutely.
So, at some patients, some VIP patients where I personally sit with my optometrist, that's true. So, sometimes if you take off ones which are just standing out there and you just want to take them off and you look at the RMS and the PSF, they go worse. So then you fine tune slowly over time, or you leave it on the manager.
Sir, I call it as we word it as it's a commensal of aberrations. It's like commensal microbes. Some aberrations are necessary to keep you exactly on a nice hold. The more and more you take it off, it can actually increase. Abhijit, you want to comment on this quickly, please?
Yeah, definitely there is some level of optimization going on there.
Can you hold the mic closer, please? Yeah.
Some level of optimization going on there, like he said, because you are trying multiple combinations and trying to minimize either the volume or the depth, okay? It can be achieved in multiple ways, but again, what is used in the software is obviously proprietary. I have one question for you is, you have 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th. I mean, what is the accuracy level for an 8th order and 7th order correction? Because, what literature in general suggests and what has been measured even in corneas is, it's going to be very hard to ablate 8th order
abnormality correction, seventh order abnormality corrections. I mean, can't we keep them off by default?
Abhijit, that's what I do. After all this machine does all this jargon, what I do is I knock all them off.
Yeah,
many
because
times.
You can reduce your optimization time for the software. You just do up to maybe at best fifth, because it gives some continuity from the fourth order. And six, seventh, eight are, I mean, you will be having probably ablations less than 1 micron for those aberrations.
Yeah, you are absolutely right that if you go for the higher order aberrations, the sixth, seventh, eighth order, the influence is very minor, very little. As well, if you go to the periphery, to the radial order, the more you go to the, in principle, the more you go to the outside, the less influencing are these higher order aberrations. However, we have seen on our testing laboratories when we started some many years ago with the PMMA trials that up to the seventh order and the eighth orders, they still influence our ablation pattern. So we have seen and measured in differences, and we have discussed also with the diagnostic manufacturer of the Sirius and the Scout if we can increase the measurement of the higher orders up to the 8, 9, 10 orders, and to see if this increase of the input preciseness will also be beneficial on that. But however, it still remained on that, and we are pretty sure that the difference will be noticeable in the ablation if we add the seventh and eighth order.
Maybe I'm asking a basic question, but how do you alter volume without altering depth?
How do we alter?
You say that you have an option of altering volume or depth.
Yeah.
So how do you alter volume of ablation without altering depth?
No.
Is it just by the optic zone size? Or?
If you click on optimize volume, it also will influence the depth. And if you click on, of course, if you click on depth, it will also influence volume. But the difference is, if you click on the depth, it will mainly look to save tissue on the deepest point of the ablation. Anyway, if the deepest point of ablation is in the central area or for some reasons in the periphery, it will save and bring down the ablation on the deepest point of the ablation. Whereas if you press volume, it might be that before optimization, that the ablation is maybe 25 microns on the deepest point, and you optimize the volume, and still your depth is 25 microns. But you reduce the overall volume, the whole amount of tissue. But sometimes also the minimized depth will also bring down this in this situation to maybe 20 microns. So we cannot predict this. It's just that the software is going, putting every single aberration on and off, and then the next on and off, and in all combinations. So we have thousands of combinations, and the software is checking this in the background, and we have to see what comes out. So it's not a predictable algorithm.
So one question, if you minimize depth, let's say you minimize depth, right? So is the volume also going to reach a minimal, or can it go beyond what you would get for minimized volume?
Yeah, it can get beyond.
It can go beyond, right?
Yeah.
Because you're not optimizing for volume, you're optimizing for depth.
What depth?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So sometimes what you can also customize is, say, let's assume that, let's forget about his keratoconus. Let's assume this patient is a normal guy. He's a 39-year-old person. So if it's a 39-year-old person, you can tell the machine that do not alter or correct the spherical aberration also. Right, Thomas?
Sorry?
If it's a pre-presbyopic person,
yeah,
where you don't want to create him going towards a positive, because you can knock, you can just tell the machine, do not touch the spherical aberration, keep the aberration as it is.
Yes,
so basically what you're trying to do to tell the machine is, keep it at whatever level it is preoperatively. So the machine will keep it, will not alter your SA. If you're altering your SA, because tomorrow morning if it's a 39-year-old person, he will start getting, the first thing you'll have is the reading issues. That's also an option here. Good. We go to the next case. I think this kind of cases, the next case what we are going to get is something which all of you are going to get in future. This is a patient who was operated for LASIK surgery many years back, and she's always had this issue with Claire, and now she's come to you for cataract surgery. The challenge here is, this is not the patient. This is the same one? Okay. The challenge here is you have a very small zone, very flat cornea. You can look at it. It's a 44 and 49. And I mean, you can do a good cataract surgery. You can end up having a lens in her. This was a PRK. I'm talking about 20 years back. Glare all our life. I'm sure you'll have lots of these patients coming into your cataract now. So we started doing this with the Alcon machine, but now we have also, we can do it here. Is first step is you do a trans PRK to enlarge the zone, regularize it. We published this work of Matthew and me 2 or 3 years back of 8 to 10 patients where we did, and then we did the cataract surgery. They're phenomenally impressed by the surgery because, can you go back to the... So this is some case where you can involve this to correct your cornea, rectify it. Now again, now I keep everything zero because I'm not bothered about what refractive error I'm inducing or correcting, because this is a patient who's going for a cataract surgery in 3 months. Say okay. And make it 6 zone. You can see that. Look at this patient. For a zero refractive error, she has 40-50 microns of ablation, which is necessary. And you can see that that is the amount of, that's, it means that it is inducing so much of hyperophic correction to make the patient more myopic in the center. Even we can do the same thing here. I don't want, now it's 26. I want to see how much more I can save for this patient. So in this patient, I don't want this patient to correct. I can just keep everything, or I can just go minimize depth and let's see how much it's going to correct.
As the optical zone is maybe influenced by the topography, would you go for a larger optical zone?
It's a larger zone. I'll probably stick to around 6.5. She's got a small pupil. Yeah.
Be aware that if you choose an optical zone and then if you go for the manager and optimize or minimize depth or volume, it optimizes for your selected optical zone. If you would have chosen another optical zone, maybe half a millimeter off or a little bit off, it might be that other higher order aberrations will be resulting.
So it's saying that it's a difference of 9 microns. Say okay. And it was, remember, it was 26, now it's become 20, and this was, I don't know, 21 or something, it becomes around 6. Yeah. So now, what we did for this patient is we corrected her for this one, because you can see that PACI was not so high. We did a trans PRK, it was just around 16 microns, still it was somewhere around 400, and waited for 3 months, did a cataract surgery, she's comfortable. We knocked her, if you go back to the summary, Summary. You can see that a lot of coma was corrected, and not so much of spherical aberration, but the coma.
I think I would completely endorse this, Rohit. I mean, especially for toric IOLs and toric phakic IOLs, we find that this really works, where you regularize the cornea first and then subsequently put in the lens of your choice.
3 months later.
Yeah. 3 months later, and it really works where even if a cone is there, you center it and then subsequently deal with the residual astigmatism.
It also works well, sir, for patients who are keratoconic, stable, after 45, and they come to you for cataract surgery, regularize it, cross-link it, but we don't know what happens, and then do the surgery. Because this is a great tool in the next 2 or 3 years from now, because when you have loads of these people like them who are coming to you, and you don't know what surgery and what lens to put.
I agree with that. I mean, it applies both to toric IOLs and toric phakic lenses, depending on the condition of the lens, whether what kind of surgery you are doing. But in case of multifocal intraocular lenses, those dissatisfied patients, post-surgery, do you think doing this kind of a surgery.
It works very well because what happens here is you are only correcting the corneal plane. So if you are sure that your cornea is the culprit, what I do in this patient is take the image like how they have done, put it onto this, look at the CW and see if it's irregular on the corneal front, and if it's irregular, do a trans PRKS and done. We have done one or two of these patients where you can do everything the same, but trans PRKS. The challenge after doing your IOL is, what happens is, it may induce myopia to this patient. If you induce myopia, then your IOL is already put here. You have no, I don't care how much it induces because I'm going to put an IOL which is going to correct it. See, because you can't be very sure that this will be emmetrope tomorrow morning. And especially a patient who, where you have made an incision, you're already biomechanically weak. I think it's a great tool for a cataract surgeon to regularize it. I'm sure you'll have lots of them coming, RKs and all those irregular ones.
So would you consider inducing spherical aberration in these patients?
It will not induce. It doesn't induce anything.
No. Would you consider inducing?
No, because you can use any lens which can give you that aspheric mode. No, we don't need to do anything in here. We'll go to the next one. The next is something which I would like to thank Hakim here. I had just got that machine, and one day he comes and tells me, this was my first case actually, and this is where I felt it's a toolbox. He was telling me that was a day I was doing a topo guided treatment. Then I asked him, can you go to one of the track mode, please? The software here is pretty slow always. Yep. So one day I was asking him that if you are in Alcon machines, you cannot decenter your ablation to where you want. So I was sitting with him and then he said, let's try. I was telling him there are times when you have a very thin cornea, the whole Athens protocol and then the Crete protocol. The Crete protocol of cross-linking is you create a PTK of 8 millimeters or 8 odd millimeters, and they found that the results of Crete protocols were better because they found that it would shave off a little bit of the cone here. So they said that because it shaves off a little bit of cone, the visual outcomes and all were better. But the biggest fallacy is the cone is not always in the center. The cone, if it's in the center, the Crete may work well. If it's here, maybe it may never work well. So he was there with me and I asked him, can you decentered here? Even he didn't know. Then he said, maybe we should, because we always look at the center to where the steep point is. That will give you the radius of curvature. So we have a session tomorrow, but today I'm just giving you an insight. So we did this, and you go to the planning, and you could actually decenter the whole ablation to where you want. For example, offset radius is where this T point is. You can keep. I'll finish this, then we'll have questions on this, and you can have. You can make the planning. Then we'll discuss. 3 millimeter, 2 millimeter. See, look at this. Keep looking at this part of the image. The machine is trying to localize where your cone is, and it will tell you, okay, this is where I'm going to ablate. And then say, okay. It keeps warning you and look at this. So what I'm going to do is, I just take only 10 microns above that area. This is done in patients who are thinner corneas. So for example, the area here is around 400, the pachy here is 430 and epithelium is say around 30 microns. Let's take that, I take it as 40 microns. So what it does is it just shaves off the cone and then I manually remove the rest of the area. And we call it as, it got published, and we have a long series now. Tomorrow, I think we'll show the data, have 1 year follow-up of close to 150 odd patients. It gives exactly the same results, or sometimes even better than a topo-guided treatment, without correcting, without burning only 10 microns tissue. Topo-guided would burn, for the same patient, let's go do a topo-guided treatment for the same patient, then we will discuss. This patient will have only 10 microns burn in that area, that's all. Because what happens is you're burning 10 microns, you're pushing the cone back, and you cross-link it.
Is this a bimodal treatment, or is just flattening out the steep area?
Just flattening of the steep area. For example, for this patient, if I had done a regular, without correcting anything, it would have burned around, this is saying around 37, 39 microns, but it's a huge amount of ablations for a 425 microns. So this, we named it as a TREC, topo-guided epithelial removal, and we published in Cornea. And for me, I have stopped doing regular cross-linkings now. My cross-linkings have completely last 1 year, maybe, I don't know numbers, but completely converted to this, because either they go for a topo-guided treatment if you have tissue, or we go in for TREC. We call it TREC because it just ablates that zone by 10 microns. The 10 microns is enough for the cornea to, and the rest, one or two diopters will be flattened over cross-linking. And we have not seen a single case of progression, because what it happens is it makes the cornea slightly fibrous because of scarring. That scarring, I think, holds it back. Pooja is going to present the data. You are leaving tomorrow, so I thought I'll discuss this today itself. And I think this is something which the company also did not know, or they knew, probably they did not advise. This is what I said, you know, you can pick up a lot of these things as you keep doing it, you know. You may probably pick up three or four other new things of this. So what has happened is this TREC, because when you say you're sending for insurance, insurance also is a topo-guided treatment now. That's the payment is different, and I charge them differently because it's not just cross-linking. And I'm not worried about burning or making the cornea weak, which we all are worried, because the corneal thickness just alters by 10 or 12 microns post-operatively at the end of 3 or 4 months. And the worry is, does it cause more haze? Initially, yes, but 3 months later, we have the data. It's the same as the other part of the cornea. So that's, again, a toolbox which you can use. Then we go last to presbyopia one. Anyway, we'll have a talk tomorrow, but just to see. And presbyopia, yes. You can choose anybody. We have two talks tomorrow, so I'm not going too deep into this, but you can choose different types of presbyopia. I think micromonovision, hybrid, and monocular. If I understand right, hybrid is something similar to what Zeiss calls it as presbyborn. Am I right?
Yes, but also micromonovision, both are them. Yeah. So the latest approach is a monocular. And in monocular, you have one eye which is for the far distance, without additional spherical aberrations, and the dominant eye and the non-dominant eye for the near, it adds a little bit of micro monovision, and on top of that, multifocality, so-called spherical aberration. Whereas the hybrid and the micro monovision, for the near eye, it's the same concept, but for the distance eye, they also add either a little bit of micro monovision, or they add a little bit of spherical aberrations to get this multifocality. And our latest approach with this monocular vision remains a kind of aberration-free treatment for the distance eye, for the dominant eye, and only gives the aberrations and the multifocality for the near eye. So this is pretty much appreciated, but it's not available since all over. It's only in the latest version.
So, but it has all the issues of a laser-based surgery on the cornea, but just for our understanding, because each company has a different terminologies given to it, and we assume that that terminology is something of their own. But if you really, if I when I go back and look at what their software and Presbybon does, I think it comes close to what hybrid is in this machine. Or like when you say Contura of Alcon, CW is Contura, exactly the same Contura.
Yeah, in this word you're absolutely right.
Exactly. So it's just a different words which is used, but of course I've done some, but it is something which one good thing is there is something called a Presby reversal. You click on that button, so it reverses back. Have you done it, Dr. Kumar? Anybody here has done it? It works well? Good.
What it induces, we have corrected by simple CW LASIK.
Yeah.
And both of them have equal results.
Good. So what happens is, for example, if I just go into this patient, you can see why it is exactly blended vision is what the Presbybon says. If you really look at what blended vision is, if you look at press 2, just write press 2. And LASIK, femto LASIK. This is the dominant eye. Say this is the dominant, near dominant, make this a near dominant. You have to always keep the zone bigger. Go to the summary, it's very interesting when you go to the summary. Which is this a near dominant eye? No, this is a distant dominant, I think. Look at this, go back. Your Presbybon does it, it gives you a blended vision because it controls your spherical aberration basically. You can see that this is distant dominant, right? This is distant dominant. The induced aberration would be around 0.58, right? And look at the near dominant because it's inducing the aberration of spherical. So if you look at this, 0.83. That means it is titrating the spherical aberration through your refractive error and getting you that depth focus through the aberration. This is exactly what blended vision of Zeiss does, the Presbybon does.
Yes, as a feedback from the market, we hear sometimes regarding presbyopic treatments with hybrid or with laser blended vision is that too much compromise on the far vision. And therefore, if we click back on the OD, and you see here it's a selected hybrid. If we would go for a monocular, this spherical aberration will be less. So it will be less squeezing on the visual acuity for the dominant eye. So this is what we have seen, at least mostly appreciated by the doctors. It makes it not similar to laser blended vision, but nevertheless, it is an advantage for the distance vision.
How many of you have done the presbyopic surgery here? Good. So one thing we have to really look at is when you're doing a presbyopic surgery, which has helped us is, part of Naren's thesis of PhD work and Abhijit's work is how much spherical aberration a human being can tolerate. Abhijit is not here. Yeah. So his work says that when your spherical aberration goes beyond, we use an adaptive optics to understand that around 0.7 or 0.8 or 0.9, you start losing a lot of depth, you lose the distance vision. Am I right, Abhijit? And a lot of other factors. So, if a patient already has a higher aberration to begin with, and if you, now in this case, you go to the next eye, you're inducing a 0.8, which is little on a higher side. If this was close to 1, then I know that the patient is definitely going to be unhappy because it is beyond the tolerance limit. The tolerance limit for a patient who can induce aberration is 0.6 to 0.7. Abhijit, you want to comment on that? Because that is very important, especially I see that if I had to do a treatment.
Yeah, so this one is being done for what is the
0.83.
Optical zone? Yeah, so 6.5 millimeter and 0.83. So when we do the adaptive optics measurement, we do for the pupil size. Okay, so when you're doing the treatment, because the treatment zone size is more, your spherical aberration is artificially inflated. So definitely if you do the patient specific measurement, you can titrate that value even better. So going back to your original question, you know, even for the monovision treatments, the near dominant eye, you can super customize if you can measure it beforehand, you know, and then program that exact number for the patient.
But yeah, if somebody is doing a presbyopia treatment and if you see the spherical aberration induced here going to be closer towards one, it gives you a rough indication that this is not going to be a very happy patient. He may drop one or two lines. So always make it, go to the summary and see. Then you can probably titrate it by reducing his power, or you can do probably different other approaches, because the tolerance limit is definitely not going to be above 0.8. No, this is near dominant. Yeah, yeah.
Hello. Yeah. So the especially in hybrid treatment, like how he suggested, and right now the trend is the monovision, because some people, even if it is 0.5 for one eye, one person might be comfortable with 0.5. Some person, one more person won't be comfortable with 0.5, and that is the dominant eye for distance. So that is the key. The non-dominant eye, even if it is 0.8 or more, still if the right eye, the dominant eye, is perfect, then absolutely he'll be very comfortable. But so the key is in hybrid treatments, the dominant eye, how much he accepts is very, very important. So that's the key thing in adaptive optics, where you can actually see what he accepts, and then finally, okay, if he's accepting, what is the upper limit, and then we go for that sweet spot, because the dominant eye is the key thing for his satisfaction.
Yeah, indeed, you have the possibility to customize the spherical aberration, the multifocality you provide for the dominant eye, by choosing either hybrid, monocular, or micro monovision. For a moment, if we look on the spherical aberration and keep it in mind, and if we look on the target, which is for this non-dominant eye,
0.89,
click on OD.
It's zero.
Target is zero, and this is 0.56. Now go back, patient data, and click on monocular. Okay. And again, summary. Click on OS, please. OS. Target is the same, 0.89, and the spherical aberration is also the same. Now click on OD. Target is zero as before, but the spherical aberrations are now much less.
Much lesser, yeah.
Yeah. And if you would have chosen micro monovision, the spherical aberration will be even higher.
Exactly. Yeah.
Basically, just to, there may be believers of laser correction or non-believers, but just to show that, to sum up on this particular segment of today's for the toolbox kit, it's really a toolbox. You're seeing that multiple things are there, but you have to keep playing with it. You have to keep going into each and every customization of this, and of course the last one is the trans-PRK, which I think will be covered tomorrow. Personally, we'll show the data tomorrow. We just analyzed our 1 year data. We started in April and we have close to 97 or 98 patients. I compared this data with the Wavefront Optimized, the Wavefront Guided, the SMILE, and all the platforms, because we had data analyzed for all of them for different papers. What is very interesting is, I don't get the right facts here, but 72% of them, 72 or 73% of them had a line improvement, and from the baseline. And I always use the pachymetry maps, and I always, we did not do anything differently. So after looking at the data, even I'm really convinced that it is getting me at least better vision than what I expected in the other technologies. Even though I'm a firm believer of quality of vision, then we looked at the quality of vision assessment, and Zelda just analyzed her results recently, and it is phenomenally good. And which I, till we do the 1 year analysis, I didn't know, because we were doing cases, but we really didn't know where we are hitting. And the range was between minus 1 to minus 7, and we're going to discuss about that tomorrow. But I think that is one thing which we have not covered in the toolbox, but that is definitely the future.
I just saw a tab there, post CXL. Can you please tell about
what
that?
What is post CXL? I have no idea.
Because that is not there in the machine which I use.
Okay, I can explain it. Post cross linking, post CXL, it should be activated. Maybe we can go on. It should be only be activated if the patient for this planning already got a full thickness cross linking in advance. So if it got a flash cross linking only for the flap, then you should not do it. Only click on the post cross linking if your patient in front of you really received a full thickness cross linking somewhere in the past. Because then the software will consider a different ablation rate for the stromal tissue, which is more rigid. Once the cross linking took place in the stroma needs more pulses to be ablated to get the same amount of depth. Otherwise, you will end up in undercorrected or under ablation.
If I'm right, I think the number is 11%. That is, the energy level is increased by 11% if the it's cross-linked.
Exactly.
So, would it be right to adapt this percentage with other machines also, in case we are doing a laser ablation on a cross-linked cornea? My question is that when you click on this button, I heard that I came to understand that the energy level is automatically increased by 11%.
Exactly.
Because that's the amount of extra energy that you need to ablate on to get the same result.
Yeah.
So, could this number be universally applicable on other machines too?
Yes. In principle, it is valid for all excimer lasers, because you ablate with the same wavelength on the tissue. And the investigation was originally made by Professor Seiler, Professor Hafezi, and one other. And they seen that the rigidity, the strengthness of the cross-linked cornea is exactly around 11%. I think Seiler found 10% and Hafezi 12%. And therefore, we end up in the middle. So this is valid and holds for all excimer lasers. So if you are not working with the Schwind, in principle, you can add 11% to your refraction, to your amount of ablation, to compensate for this. This is, in principle, what we are doing on a more elegant way.
Earlier, we were doing the 30-minute cross-linking. Nowadays, we are doing either 10-minute or 3-minute. So does that protocol work on all type of cross-linking, or it is only for the older 30-minute one?
No, it is considered for the full thickness. Anyway, if it goes for 10
full
minutes
thickness,
or 30 minutes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Full thickness, but different power and different time.
It is. It should be the same. I'm not the expert on that, but we do not differentiate. And we had discussed this, and we do not differentiate between the 10 minutes and the 30 minutes and a different level of fluence and energy. We only say if you do a flash cross-linking, so after the femtolasic or lasic itself.
No, flash cross-linking on a virgin cornea.
Flash cross-linking, you don't click on the post cross-linking.
No, so if we do a 3-minute cross-linking on a fresh cornea, like keratoconus
I don't
cornea.
Think anybody has that answer at all.
Okay.
Because this is a theoretical model. That's 11% or I think a lot of people are not being able to reproduce that because the model is completely different. But they use one model to use it. But I don't think it's not like other nomogram where you know that it is, I mean, you reduce by this much, this is what you get. But this part of the session was just an overview of what is going to be discussed tomorrow. So I'm sure there'll be a lot more sessions of this individually. But any other questions to sum it up for this? Yeah. Pardon?
These sessions needed to be done before, probably the last time we met.
You should look back and ask them.
I was just talking to the R&D team, Schwind, that this is what we were missing.
Thank you, sir. So, we have the last session. We have three cases. Something interesting. This is something which all of us can be part of this. Unfortunately, our psychiatrist was supposed to come, but she's got stuck somewhere, so I'll take her spot today. So, one of the big challenges today is it's not about, like Dr. Ramurthy said, you know, does a patient really ask for all this? Are we overdoing something? So there are a lot of these questions which keeps coming to our mind. But the problem is, there are always this occasional one or two people who come to your clinic who are terribly unhappy with you, and for no reason it spoils your, you may be traveling, you are in a conference, but they keep bugging you, you don't know what to do because they are unhappy. Even at whatever level or whatever stature you are in practice today, it just cannot stop you from getting disturbed. Dr. Ramurthy, am I right? Does it not disturb you at this stage of life when you have probably had lakhs of these patients?
He's such a fossil, I said.
I know, but I'm talking in terms of experience.
I agree.
So, I asked Pooja to collect some data because this is something which we submitted for the AACRS as a paper this time. Something totally unique is India is going to be, sorry, how do we go forward? Can somebody just, India is going to be the number one country in the world which will be depressed. This is the World Health Organization report which just came recently. The question is, how does it impact ophthalmologists? How does it impact us? Because most of those who are depressed are the ones who are in the younger age group. And the second, most of them don't even know that they are having this problem, because India has got such a big barrier against having anything called mental diseases. It's actually not mental disease anymore. We had a nice talk Wednesday. I in fact invited him also, he was busy. He's head of neuropsychiatry at our sister concern, the Narayana Heart Health. He said it's no longer a mental disease, it's an immunological disease. The mental health is not related to what Sigmund Freud said or somebody else said, where you have you have delusion, dreams. Now it's all linked to immunology, your immune system. It's just like how you have an inflammatory bowel disease, or you may have something like a cancer. So the treatment of lot of this psychological disease are going towards immune therapies now. It's not the old type where you give them, load them with all kinds of drugs which causes problem. The challenge for us here today is, out of 100, 6 of them are depressed and most of them don't know. And all of us sitting here will get, at least if you see 100 patients, you'll get 6 of them walking into your clinic not knowing that they are depressed or they are in anxious, they are in bipolar disease, and you operate on them and then the problem starts. And that's where I think it's so important. That's why I put this topic in this format, because if you don't know it, it can spoil your mood today, irrespective of what stage you are in. I have some 2 cases which will explain why we need to do it, and then we'll have a small summary of how we do it. Next slide, please. So go back, that's important. I want that ocean fi. Okay. So, there is a questionnaire because before I took up ophthalmology, I keep telling this all the time to boost my ego. I had a brief time in psychiatry as obviously as a postgraduate, and then I did not like it, then I jumped into ophthalmology. So, in one of the things about psychiatry is all about personality. There are many, many personality questionnaires because they do not treat you without knowing your personality. So we thought, why not pick up a personality questionnaire in our practice and understand the patient? This was just a study with Dr. Vaitesh, Dr. Pooja, and I thank Vaitesh, he's now in US, he finished his fellowship. After many, many trials, we picked up one question which is easy, because some of the questionnaires in psychiatry are very complicated. They go too deep into it, like, are you stressed at this point of time? Are you stressed with your husband, wife, and all that? It becomes a little difficult. So this questionnaire we had was easy because, if you go back again, somebody obviously in that group doesn't like Ocean's 11, so they just want to keep jumping. Just hold on. What is ocean? We just added this picture. What is ocean is O for openness, and C, I can't pronounce it. I think one of them, Sharon, can pronounce it. So E for extrovert, A for agreeableness, and N for neurotic. This is a very important questionnaire. I think today it may look not necessary, but one day you'll really realize how important it is. Go to the next slide now, you can jump. So this is how the big five questionnaires are. And then next clip. You can jump, skip this in the interest of time. Let's do this. So this is a patient who had a LASIK surgery 1 year back. Complaints of pain, dryness. The surgery was done somewhere in Ahmedabad. Good surgery, absolutely no problem. He has all these problems. And parents are, I think they're tailors. They stopped working because they had this, it's one of those single son syndrome. Everything revolves around that son. And mother, father, everybody has stopped working because the son is having a lot of them. They say that his personality changed. And when he went to a doctor saying that I got into a suicidal tendency, then the doctor felt that this is the time he has to go somewhere. So look at the symptoms. He has pain, dryness, inability to focus, ghosting and doubling. Typical of refractive surgery. Let's go to the next step. Basically everything was normal. That was his dryness was not really related to post-refractive surgery. 8 or 10 seconds is still okay. Then we go to the next step. So I do a lot of confocal work just to see if there's anything else. Even that for him had some dendritic cells which you can, you know, which were leading, though, but it's nothing important. So we did not know. Just hold on, please. So we do not know why he has so much of pain and dryness. So we did not know why he was not able to focus. We did not know what was his reason for him to show all these changes. So the next step we did was we do a lot of optics work. One of the areas of interest now has been accommodating and how the accommodation really works. And this is from Osiris, and what you see here is the red deer is that he's accommodating from the time he sits on the machine. That means he's pseudo-accommodating. And pseudo-accommodation, you can see that the stimulus is here, he's already accommodating here, so it's already there. So what we did was, he knows that two things here is also pseudo-accommodating. Then the third thing, next step. So that probably we felt was the cause of it because it's a 20/20, it's not a myopes. It's very unusual. It's not very usual to see somebody pseudo-accommodating so much and not having an induced myopia and still reading 20/20. So the third question was, why is he having, these are all his problems. This is what is making him suicidal. And ghosting and doubling. So what we felt is, this is something which is very important. There are people who came to with me in the afternoon to our orthoptics and binocular vision testing lab. 88% to 90% of the patients who come to you with ghosting are not cornea related. They are all one of them. Dysfunctional vergence, fusional dysfunctions, accommodation excess, convergence excess. What happens is we are always revolving around the topography. And what we did was, this patient had dysfunctional vergence facility which causes him to show doubling of images, which is not glare. And sometimes, you know, you ask the patient, they always come to you with glare because glare is a bird in the Google. Because when you ask him deep, then you will start show that it's not glare, I see a little doubling, then you know that he's got this. So an orthoptics examination, and or you make your optometrist to learn orthoptics, it's the most important thing. And then, because he was from Ahmedabad, and this needs an in-hospital exercise. We have people who came with me today. It's a every day, 1 hour, they come to the hospital. It's like a physiotherapy. When patient asked me, why do you want me to come? I said, it's a physiotherapy for the eye, and physiotherapy can be done in the hospital. So, I mean, we did that. for 15 days, he, and we treated his dry eye the normal way, lots of counseling, then he had to go for antidepressants, and then finally, you can just go to the next one. And this one patient needed all these things, including then he went to psychological counseling in those 15 days time. And after the surgery was done 2013, so he now is completely free from everything. He's free from the dryness. His accommodation is become better because we have given him that exercises. It's a home-based exercises also. His convergence has improved. It is no more excess. And with all of these changes, along with the, he needed some lot of psychotherapy, and I think his psychology improved. He's gone back to college. And imagine his parent had stopped, his father is a tailor, had stopped his tailor shop, and they all have gone back to wherever, whatever they were doing before the surgery. So it takes a lot of efforts from one step to the other to make them better, because if one of these patients claims that refractive surgery pushed him to suicide, then all of us here will be jobless in a few years' time, because the patient's mindset, I mean, the perception of what happens outside is very important. And this is a very good example of how each one was confusing the doctor. The patient kept telling that I have pain. The doctor kept treating for dry eye. The pain was not the dry eye. The pain was because of convergence excess. He kept telling that I have double vision. He was always treated with different types of medications, because they said that it is because of your corneal irregularity. There was no corneal irregularity there. And his psychology, they felt that he's a different individual. I mean, people, they did not really place him what kind of an individual he was. They just kept kept pushing him to an edge where he needed something which is drastic. And that's a classic example in this case. Next one. So this is a patient who underwent, again, go to the next one. This is my patient. It's very interesting, you know. He's a 28-year-old male, underwent LASIK surgery 6 years back. Now he's complaining of blurring of vision. And he comes to us saying that I have blurring of vision and I see everything glare in the night. Unfortunately, he's posted in Jammu and Kashmir on the border, and he's one of those, I don't know what they call, like the Navy SEALs in US, is one of those frontline guys. Very, is not a complaining sort. Next slide. Cornea was perfect. You can see the lens having accommodation there. We can see that that's a classic thing. Next slide. That's an accommodation issues. We can see that again. What is happening here is this is a classic pseudo-accommodative spasm. What is happening is he looks like he's very strong, he's mentally prepared to, but there is a lot of fear. When I talk to him, there is a tremendous amount of fear, because there were two people in his group who died recently, fighting terrorists. He said he showed me the papers. He showed me a lot of things. Where there is, he says that I see a death every week near to me. And he says, I don't know what, and that fear made him to have this kind of a picture. And the issue is, along with this, you can't give him an homide drops, because if you give homide drops, he can't work, because I believe there's no leave there. He says, only time you get leave is you're hurt or you're dead. So he had to go back, then the slide. His problem was convergence excess. And his problem was nothing to do with the cornea. What he was happening is, when he was looking at the gun and is trying to shoot, the convergence is so much that it goes into an excess. Then a slide. And these are all some of the exercises which we give them. Next slide. And you see, not put different patient, but you can see how it changes with 15 days exercise. The glare, and this is not just for refractive surgery. This happens a lot with multifocal surgeries. And many times, you elderly patients have so much of convergence and accommodation weakness, until unless, that's the time, any time we have Pooja has made a flow chart of what we do when we see a glare patient. Glare, again, I'm saying, is a Google word. So most of the people who complain of glare have some or the other accommodation weakness. We had a very senior Supreme Court judge, a lawyer. He was operated somewhere in North, and he had come to us because he had tremendous amount of glare. It was not glare. It was just that he had convergence, fusional issues, and he underwent 15 days of this vision therapy, the exercises, and he's completely back to normal. You can see the difference. We have not given anything for this patient. This is just 15 days change in the accommodation. Next slide. And I will end up with this patient. This I posted in one of the groups also. A 29-year-old male patient underwent LASIK 1 week back. 1 days later, he comes to the clinic. I was in my lab meeting. When I came back, Pavitra had seen the patient. Patient and his attendants very angry because he says that he's got some major problem with his vision. He's grumpy, his depression, he's off food for 3 days. And he kept repeating that he locks himself, says that something has gone wrong, I want to commit suicide. Vision is perfect. What do you do with them? So we know that these are the patients who are having psychological issues after discussing all this. Next slide. You can skip this because we already know. This is just to show the accommodation spasm in him again. The red color shows the spasm. This is an abrometry of the lens. Next slide. Orthoptics again. She took him to the orthoptics. He was so angry with everybody that he just said, I will not do anything. So by the time he was angry, I had come back from a lab meeting and I saw him. And you can see that we had already made him feel the, this is something which we had done, but we had never seen that. When you actually, this is a questionnaire which actually they write it. And we add it into all our files. After this, I decided to look at all the personalities. You can see that if you grade it, there's a scoring system to it. He was already a neurotic. These questions, they don't know what they're writing. They can write, there are a lot of questions. Are you open to people? Are you open to talks? Are you open to new people? So when they write yes, no, and all, you can actually fill it up. Then, so, when we discussed with him, he just told me that I'm a chronic smoker, but your secretary asked me not to smoke, so I stopped smoking. Then I realized that it's something to do with the withdrawal, but when I send him to a psychiatrist, the way I send him to a psychiatrist is, I never tell them it's a mental disease, I tell them it's something to do with your hormones, and now with a lot of new insights, it's something to do with immunological change. Neuropsychiatry is immunological change now. So when I say that, they accept it better. We never use the word that you have a mental or you have a psychological thing. And he went there. What was happening is because my secretary asked him not to smoke, he was heavy on drugs with his friend and he stopped the drugs. All he had was a withdrawal symptoms. And after his friend gave him one puff, he felt better the same day evening. So I continued, asked him to continue with whatever he's doing because there's no point stopping in. Then next one. So if there's anything interesting here. Yeah, this is one patient who is giving sleepless night to a very prominent doctor in North. And exactly the same thing. That's what I asked Dr. Ramamurthy. He's senior to Ramamurthy, sir. Maybe started LASIK before, and he is threatening him every alternate day that I'm going for exactly the same problem, and he needs an immediate admission, which is not ready. His problem is, look at this. The stress has induced so much that he's just not coming, he's not ready for anything. This is everyday practice. The cases I showed are just 1-2 weeks back. So I can pick up every day. You have so many of them walking into your clinic. Next slide. You can change. You can go. Do we have the personality questionnaire for this one? This next slide. So what we did was to end this part of the talk, if I convince you enough that you need to be very, very mindful of, you have that slide? So if somebody comes to you with glare, whether it's refractive or cataract, understand this ocular surface, internal orthoptics, please always look at this. And most important thing is the personality. You don't need to have a questionnaire. Just talk to him for 5 minutes. You'll know how anxious it is. And these two things are usually missed because we do the abrometry, but we don't do the personality and orthoptics. So that is something which is a take home from all these cases. And please go back and inform your, pick up one of your optometrists who is good or trained. You might have 3 optometrists who may be good in all this, but they have never been used. Make them into use because it will be a very big asset for you, especially in your refractive and cataract practice. Next slide. Yeah.
I want to share one incident. A patient with squint came to us, and major squint, and he was sent to one of our clinics for the squint specialist. Squint was corrected, but he suddenly started having diplopia. This patient was up for marriage in next 2 months. The slight amount of diplopia, he did express to my squint surgeon that I will commit suicide because I wanted to, you know, get rid of my squint for marriage. But the squint is gone, but I am seeing 2 people. My squint specialist did not take it seriously. That man committed suicide. And then in the suicide note, he named my surgeon as a reason for suicide. Now this is true story, 4 years ago. Luckily for me, the patient's parents were very educated. And they realized that he'd gone into a depression. So there was no legal suit. But this is the power of depression. So I've lived that. I have another patient who was operated elsewhere in Delhi for -8 ICL done. His father was forcing him to join army because the father was an army man and the boy didn't want to. His vision got corrected, so he got selected in medical board. He said, I will commit suicide because I am not happy with the newfound vision. And I had a long chat with the parents. I spent 1 1-hour sessions with the boy. And then he shared that he wanted to be an artist. He did not want to join the army. But with the corrected vision, his family was forcing him to join army. So he will kill himself or I should take out the ICLs. So it took me 6 sessions with the parents to tell them that don't make him join army or I take out the ICLs. And guess what happened? The boy was so adamant and the parent was so adamant, I had to take out the ICLs. He would come to my clinic and cry for 3 hours that I will not join the army. And my father is with the Jat family, very dominating patriarchal family. And the father said, even to a 19-year-old boy, he said, I will whip you with a stick if you don't join the army. So the boy said, I will kill myself if you don't take these ICLs out. So I said, why don't you go to the people who've operated you? Go back to them. I don't want to do that. But this is the power of the mental state. One man committed suicide and I couldn't get it off my conscience. And I told my squint specialist that why didn't you talk to me that the boy's talking to you like that? So when I saw this man going on that lane, I told the parents, we will take out the lenses. And he's happier wearing -8 glasses than he was 6x9 one eye and 6x6 with ICLs in the eye. So this is real story.
One very important take-home point from this is you writing in a file that patient is depressed is not going to save him if he has a problem. So it is very important when you note somebody in a psychological stress to refer to a psychiatrist, and they have to document that he is psychologically ill. So the doctor I was just mentioning, who is in North and who has been really been upset with this person, he was not able to convince him to go to a psychiatrist. Fortunately, I made him to meet a psychiatrist, and psychiatrist has written every single thing what he has done. So I told him that in case he commits suicide, you have a clear document that this person has depression even before surgery, and he is not been taking treatment, and he is on multiple drug abuse. Multiple different things. So it is very important when you note somebody who is bothering you or who is not happy with your surgery and he believes that it is related to you, you have to document with the psychological assessment. And personality plays such a huge impact on your outcome. We did a small study. We gave the same questionnaire to patients undergoing PRK. A person with more openness or more, who was more, I would say, a more extrovert person had always less pain compared to the ones who had more neurotic or more complex personalities. I'm not saying the questionnaires are gold standard, but at least it gives you some amount of baseline. And I personally believe that it is very important when you don't want to do a surgery for somebody, because today it's not about doing numbers, it's about having a peace of mind. And one or two of these patients who keep threatening you with all kinds of suicidal notes are ones who need this counseling. Any questions?
Rohit, can we get a copy of your question?
Yeah, we can do that. It's freely available.
And his vision was 20 by 10. What I know is that in a accommodation spam, generally the vision is not 20 by 10.
Yes.
Pseudo-myopia
is induced. Yes, there are two types of, what I've realized is accommodative spasm related only to the lens changes, lens moving forward, which we see in children. You see a myopic shift and vision drops by a line or two. But in patients who have accommodative spasm related maybe to convergence or fusional versions deficiencies, then you don't see them dropping lines. They see double vision. So, I mean, I don't, because this is something which is very emerging for, I'm also learning, because accommodation spasms come in different colors. One with drop in vision, one with just having that double vision. And to sum up, I can send this article to this group also. And this is a story of, this is the New England Journal of Medicine. This is a story of a first year medical student who was taking history. And after all the detailed history is done, his professor comes and asks him, this guy is fully ready with all the history, diagnosis and all that. And the first question his professor asks him is, what is the name of the dog, this gentleman who's having injury? And obviously nobody teaches to go and ask into that depth. So the patient just mumbles same something like Rocky or something. But he then gives the whole story of, it's not a history of story about what was the necessity to ask the name of the dog. It's the story about how you have to be aware of every single thing when the patient is in your room. And our chairman has this very nice way of explaining it. He says mindfulness. He says your mind has to be fully in that place. Because today, I see that the amount of people who are unhappy with your surgeries, who are unhappy with many, many things, especially, I don't know, it's maybe same everywhere, but in Bangalore, it's a huge rise. And especially some areas where Naren has a hospital, it's so IT driven that they just burn you out by end of the day. So being mindfulness is, in psychiatry, this is something they teach us. When you go into a room, how does an anxious patient sit? And we have to note down all this. The anxious patients will never sit like how Naren is sitting. He will never relax and sit. He will be at the edge. And it's such a simple and easy way in psychiatry. We would always pick up the traits by how they sit. And even in my practice, I tell all of them, is you tell how he sits. They will never ever sit fully like this. Because they always have that feeling of living on the edge. That is one trait. The second is the neuropsychiatric patients are the ones who never ask. They're not the ones who will ask you questions. Because when they ask questions, you already label them as somebody who is not good. These patients will always be very quiet and they never ever look at you and speak. Their eye is always looking down. And that is the second trait. And the third thing is, they always have some personal issues in the recent past which they're not discussed with the family. They just had to bring it out open. And the surgery is always the first, it's like you're punching bag. Any questions on this before we end for dinner? Thank you. Thanks a lot. And we have a long day tomorrow. Because we had to, lot of flights are at late evening, so we had to finish everything before 5 o'clock, 4:30, I think. So we request all of you, please be here by 8 o'clock, so that we can discuss like how we had today. Thank you.